conferencing, online collaboration, etc., etc. These are very industry-focused terms. People like yourselves wouldn't know what you're talking about. So we really took a step back and said, okay, how can we get terms that can be relevant to our target audience? So by this research, she identified that. So video conferencing, big search term, everyone understands what that is, online meetings, etc., etc. So the biggest lesson you guys can learn is always be relevant to your target audience and always test. Because trust me, I've spent months, years, doing things I think are right, but actually there's a massive disconnect between what we want to push and what's actually relevant to the market we're trying to get involved with. So that's kind of a summary for how we do our kind of, you know, a keyword search and like that. Once we've got that, we then use variations on it. So for example, online meetings, something that we know works really well. We'll then build content around that. So Simon, who provides all that content, can write blogs. And we can just start to build a general level of noise around kind of how we can start to engage with people on that. Any questions so far? Does that make sense?
You know, you were talking about the crazy egg software.
Yes.
Well, how exactly does that work?
How does it work?
How does it work?
So what it does is you embed some code into your websites, and every time someone goes onto the website and clicks on something, you can see a heat map how that works.
So for example, okay, this is the meetings on website. We're running it for, I don't know, a day, 2 days. So what's your name?
Alexa.
Alexa goes onto the website, she's looking around, and she can't see what she wants. I can then see, she's scrolling up and down, I can see exactly why she's confused, because what she wants to find isn't there. So that tells us, okay, there's a problem there. Mm. People aren't finding what they want. And you can use AdWords, there's so many tools out there, but Crazy Egg's really good because it gives a visual representation of what you can see is going on. And it's a great tool. Don't you recommend it?
In terms of your acquisition on the site, where are most kind of sessions coming from?
At the moment on the new site,
yeah.
So a lot of people click on our blogs. So the way people consume content on our website, in our industry, is people want to see for themselves how their services could benefit them. So we have a number of blogs, a WebEx blog, we have a Cisco Spark blog. And what we're trying to tell people is, you know what, see for yourself how these services can benefit. Here's some scenarios. So we did a really good blog the other day on a life in the time of an HR director. And it basically speaks about, I go to work, you know, 9 o'clock, get in, I'm really busy, I'm speaking to a colleague over in America, I don't want to pick up the phone and speak to them because it's hard to be lost. I want to have a face-to-face meeting with them. These are the benefits I can get from having this face-to-face meeting in a real-life situation. So in our industry, people don't just see an ad and think, yes, I'm going to buy £1,000 WebEx license. It doesn't work. You know, they want to see the benefits themselves. So they look, they go on the blogs, they go on the websites. Our event tracking on our website says that it takes between 8 and 9 visits for people to actually transact with us. You know, and that's the nature of it. We have to try and, you know, show the benefits of a service in real time, in a real life situation for people who are going to interact.
So the majority of people log in, so is that from?
Blog links to get them involved, get them interested. So we'll post something on, say, LinkedIn, and it'll be like, you know, check out our latest blog on how flexible working can work for you, 10 top tips. Nothing too direct. It gives people the opportunity to read for themselves and make their own decision. And then, because on our site we have something called AdRol, retargeting. Do you guys know about retargeting in marketing? So when you go on a website, a little banner flashes up and you get away from it, it follows you around the website. You probably see it when you go to the consumer brands. And it's a really good tool because, say, if you read a blog about flexible working, you go onto the site, accept cookies, you go elsewhere, you go onto, I don't know, Daily Mail, wherever you guys go, and then it pops a little banner saying, you know, meeting zone, online collaboration services, or whatever. It's always there in your face. It just keeps reminding you it's a touch point. And that's part of our strategy. We want people to come to the website to engage with us. When they go, we're going to be hitting them with retargeting information. So we're creating touch points. The more touch points we can create, the more chance to come back to the website, and then they can transact with us. Any other questions?
Are you developing a mobile app or mobile software?
Yes. to your question, we are indeed doing that. As with most things in life, everything is mobile. We have, as part of our services, an online portal they can go and access where people have had their phone calls or their WebEx meetings. At the moment, it's a bit clunky. People complain because they can't access it on their mobile.
Mm.
So that whole proposition about kind of company is going to be put onto an online platform.
So mobile, like the roaming costs would be more, wouldn't they?
Exactly.
Because of location.
Exactly. And it's all about how people digest the content on a member's area. People, like if you're on Vodafone or whatever mobile network you're on, you want to access your account, it's an app, right? You know, most things you do nowadays are mobile app based, and that's just the way things are going. So we're doing the same thing, click on an app, all the information you want, good to go.
Is security more of an issue as well on the mobile device?
Absolutely. You know, we have a number of legal customers, and their paramount thing is security.
Mm.
They don't care about price.
Now, yeah.
Exactly. So for us to have that security built in is, you know, really important.
Mm.
So, yeah.
So does that limit the number of people you partner with? So Cisco and Skype business?
Yeah, so our proposition as a brand is we are what's called a power reseller. So we partner with Skype, Microsoft and Cisco. Means as a brand its own probably isn't strong enough to attract the really big customers that we're after. People always know who Cisco are, and certainly Microsoft. So if we can say to them, actually, you know what, we'll give you these two great services with a bit of value add because we know what we're talking about, and we'll give you the best customer support money can buy, that's what people come to us. And we push that in all advertising. We really lean on those two power brands because we can't do it on our own.
Okay, and what about additional software that you might...
So we have our own in-house conference call service set up, and our kind of go-to-market strategy is, you want these two brands, fantastic. By the way, we can also give you some conference call stuff as well to piggyback that service onto the two power brands, and that is our strategy.
Are you doing a call tracking?
Sorry?
Call tracking?
Yes. So we do some event tracking, so because of privacy laws, I can't see your details as a user to our website, but
yep.
I can tell how many times you come to the website, how many pages you're on, how long you stay on the website, I can see when you exit and come back. So it's quite interesting to mention that. We've been doing some tests on this, and there was one user came to the website, I think it was back in July, a little around.
So how are you doing this macro recording?
I'm sorry?
Are you doing the macro recording of scripts?
Yes.
Scripts?
Exactly. So back to what I was saying, this was one gentleman, came to the site in May, disappeared, came back again in August, September, October, and then eventually, this month here, he actually transacted with us. So we've got that recorded down, that whole journey.
Yeah.
I can get that on the Google.
Are you using like a third party company?
No, Google Analytics can do that for you. Yeah, it's called direct event tracking. And this is scripts for you, the whole thing. So. Any other questions for anybody?
Yeah, how do you go about researching for new content?
So when we do our kind of marketing campaigns, the first thing we do is we do what's called a test campaign. So go back to this whole thing about being relevant. So we'll just pitch little messages and see what people, how people react to it.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, that gives us the ideas. So we've done a campaign targeting the transport logistics industry. And before we do anything, we use LinkedIn pay-per-click platform. And we pitched, I think it was about 12 or 13 different ads, different messages, so we want to see what works. And from there, you can see what message people click on, who the demographic is. So for example, Alexa could be the prime target. She could be working in transport logistics for a company that is 200 to 500. Her job title is HR director. And she's the kind of person we want to target, and we know the content we want to push to her. So from there, we know to build content out from that. So we've got blogs, we've got a landing page, we've got dynamic ads, the whole lot. So it comes back to one thing, being a relevant target audience.
Can you give an example?
Do you want to go to the blog slide?
when I talked to you last time about how we surround our target audience with noise, positive noise, to create a predisposition towards the brand and start this relationship build, which is really what we're trying to do. So what I was talking about is some of the stuff here. So for example, I'll show this one, Rob.
Yeah, the last one. So this blog here, going back to what I was saying, we know this content is going to be read by people because we've done the testing, we know. And these are kind of the kind of key points that people in that industry are looking for. So the content's not going to be wasted, it's going to be relevant to what they want.
So Rob's talking about relevance. You know, is we talked about personas last time. So understanding what makes people tick in the public sector, and the person that runs the public sector sales initiative, they're very close to these people, so they know what they're like. But we also have our thoughts and views on it. So it's about understanding what sort of messages are going to resonate, and then creating noise around that. So there's blogs, there's other white papers in this area. You know, there's opportunities to meet people face to face through events that we've taken advantage of. And then all the pay per click to actually get in front of them. But the key thing is when they want to come to us, that they find us. So that's where the SEO and the keyword stuff comes in.
Yeah, and this is what it's all about. These blogs here are fantastic for SEO because one thing Google likes is human content written on a regular basis. We know that you can never copy and paste content from one website to the other because you get blacklisted. Big no-no. So these blogs here are fantastic for SEO. And there's a big myth about what's better, SEO or pay-per-click. Well, the fact that they work together hand in hand. You know, Google have now updated their algorithms. I think it's January they'll be launching the new ad sets. So now you get 3 lines of text in your Google paid search ads, which then makes it a lot longer to see any SEO. So it's really important that you do both.
Have they already done that with extended keywords?
They have extended it. They haven't rolled it out fully yet. They had a problem with other algorithms. So they pushed the date back to January for the full launch out. So we can do that. But again, it does, obviously, people who sit at the bottom of a page in SEO,
yeah,
done.
Mm-hmm.
You can see. So it's really important that you push up as much as possible. So you get 2 positions on the first page, you can.
Have you noticed the effects of that being pushed down and sort of through paid adverts?
I think there's positives to it. I think if you can get up in the page, it's good because the ads are so much bigger now. You can actually explain what your proposition is about. I think the old style, you had like, I don't know, 10 words or something to try and get across your message. Pretty difficult in our industry because we need to explain what we do. But it will have an effect, you know. We're lucky because WebEx is one of our main terms. We are the number one reseller,
yeah.
So we're number one on the first page.
But would it have an effect in terms of your distribution of paid and organic content, as in, would you want to do more paid to get to the top of that page?
Yeah, it depends. If you're struggling to get on that first page from an actual search point of view, then yes, you would need to probably increase it. You need to have that presence. But you still shouldn't ignore it. You know, Google effectively is trying to push you down the road of do both. You know,
yeah.
Having good SEO will help lower your keyword costs. So the way Google works is if you have real content on your website and you're trying to push a paid ad to it, if the content's really natural and well written, then you'll lower the keyword cost.
Mm-hmm.
And vice versa, it's led rubbish, it's backing right up. So that's why it's important to have D2.
So what sort of search terms did you guys come up with when you were looking at SEO?
Yeah. That's short enough to do it, though. There's a list. You guys find things, right?
Yeah. Why don't we put one in and see what you think? Do you see where we... What do you think?
Conference calls.
Power now. Yeah, power out of the way, bro.
Yeah. Probably worth explaining why that is, Rob.
So PowerNow are a competitor of ours. They spend a fortune on paid and natural search, and see the benefits for it. They write probably 2 or 3 blogs a day, massive social media presence. And again, Google likes that. The more content you're pushing out there on a regular basis that's natural and well-written, you're going to be credited for it. And if you're not, the opposite.
What are the key things that come through the Penguin updates?
Yes.
Penguin 4? What's the new stuff that's...
So the Penguin updates really just is this Google way of updating their algorithms, so they're looking for you to see, is your content written by a human being? That's all it is. And they're getting smarter and smarter. Now it's to a point now where they can literally detect if you're repeating small phrases in content.
Mm-hmm.
It's their way of trying to police the internet, saying, right, we don't want people copying, we want content that is always fresh, always written by a human being, and not just by a tool or a bot.
So written by humans for humans, I think is the mantra.
Exactly.
We got stung on that, didn't we, Rob?
Everyone's, yeah, we got, when I first joined, we used an agency who used the bot to create the content, and surprise, surprise, Google caught onto it, and we were blacklisted for about a couple of months. Wouldn't appear anymore on Google.
Just fell from the sky.
Yeah.
You know, we were on the first page for some of the key terms.
Yeah.
We just fell from the sky.
Yeah. But the thing is, Google will never tell you what you should be doing. They'll give you little hints. It's a cat and mouse game, pretty much. So it can be difficult. Sometimes, you know, we've had a few updates, but actually we benefited from it because we've had lots of really good content, and sometimes we've dipped a little bit as well.
Mm-hmm.
Backlinks, you know, how many hyperlinks have in a bit of content as well. If you have too many, Google might think it's trying to spam. System too little, content relevant, so it's always balancing acts. And, yeah, I always say test. It's the only way you can get around it.
What about the way that those networks of these really obscure sites for backlinks? Is that what's happening on that front now?
Yeah, Google. What Google is trying to get around now is what's called spamming, backlink spamming, where you get a bit of content and you literally just try and whack as many backlinks onto random sites as possible. And that used to be the way to get your site up.
You could buy them, couldn't you? You could rent your brand on some really obscure site.
There were a lot of companies out there who charged a lot of money to do that. They did really well. And then Google found out what was going on, and then, yeah, game over. So now it's not about quantity of backlinks, it's quality and relevance. So our website here, if we're doing some backlink work on, say, you know, a conference call provider website that's listing stuff, fantastic, that's relevant. If you put your backlinks onto something like, you know, Burgers R Us, not relevant, and we get penalised for it. So, again, yeah, always back to relevance. If being relevant, if the content is fresh, Google will like you. If you don't, build in bad things.
I think, yeah, the industry's grown up. It was a bit of a cowboy industry, SEO, when it first started. And you had these guys who could say, we've got this fantastic network of 10,000 sites, and we'll put your link on there. Nobody ever goes to these sites, by the way. There's no content on there of any note. But it's a backlink. Whereas now, it's about, okay, if we can be on a quality site, you know, we're better off being on one quality site than a whole load of sites that big Google penalises for.
Yeah. And also keywords as well. The other thing people used to do back in the day was keyword stuffing. So you create a page, you go into the back end of your analytics or your HTML, and you chuck in a million times the keyword you want. And again, you see really well of it. Google found out, and surprise, surprise, you can't do it anymore. So again, when you're doing your content, always try and have a natural amount of keywords that you're trying to put. So in our blogs, we don't try and make a product at least maybe twice maximum. That's kind of a nice balance. Google tends to like that.
Is there a sort of playbook you can use for, you know, avoiding black hat SEO, do more white hat type?
Yeah, there are. In fact, the agency I work with, they do have a playbook. I can circulate to you guys. I would say one thing though, it does go out of date very quickly. So don't use it as a more of a rough guide. This industry, things change very, very quickly, by the day almost. So, you know, there's actually a really good publication called Clicks. It's a free publication. I recommend all of you get onto it today. And they literally have updates on digital worlds, you know, twice a day. SEO, got great, what's it called?
So Clicks with a Z or an S?
C-L-I-C-K and Z at the end. I read that every day, part of my job, because it gives me some information. And again, it's great you guys keep up to date on how you should be moving. So.
These little gems are brilliant for getting good marks in assignments.
Yeah.
It's great to tell you.
So just in terms of the types of content they use, I mean, I've noticed sometimes if you go to the Power Now, for example, they'll rank for search terms that they're trying to sort of like clickbait you and get you into.
Yes.
But then there's no content on the back of it. So,
yeah, so
it's just straight to their site.
Yeah, so it was paid ad, was it?
I think that was
SEO.
It's paid, I think.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a paid ad, yeah.
So so what they've done here is they're quite smart. So they've basically got dedicated landing pages for their paid ads. Because their proposition is basically about getting a conference call now, think straight to a landing page, enter your email, boom, away you go. And that works really well. We do the same thing, actually. We've got a conference now equivalent service.
Is that more effective than writing a long piece of content?
In this instance, yes. Because their proposition is about instant conference call. You know, it's, they don't really want you to do too much. They want you literally to go here, type in your email, go. So when you're building landing pages, you need to ask yourself the question, what do you want people to do? Do you want people to do something very quickly? In that case, this is it. Or do you want to educate them? So it might be a case of, okay, we've got a product coming out. People might not understand what it's about, so therefore we're going to educate them. So we're going to put into a bit of long content, where you read about it, understand it. Normally, brands will do two things. They'll have one page like this, where we educate, they're good to go, and another page where actually you need to read about it, understand it.
Rob mentioned we've got a separate brand called Conference Now that plays in this market. This is a market where you don't actually need a contract. If you need to make a quick conference call, you may not even remember the last provider you used. You just go in, stick your email address, get a PIN, dial the numbers, give the PIN to all the people you want to join the call at the time, and you come. So you've got this pool of people at any given time want to create a conference call. So it is about who's got the biggest net to capture as many of these people as you can. You can't pay per click, well you can if you've got the money and Power Now do, all the time. You can't always be present, because I'm sure some of you that are doing advertising modules or marketing modules, you haven't got the money to cover that. So you've got to be very careful about when you're putting your ads in the market, when are people actually looking to use this service, and then make sure that you've got enough standout in your ad, because it's more likely to be ads, isn't it, Rob?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at this page here, it's actually quite good. Their whole push is about being really quick. So they mentioned here, start a conference call in just a few seconds. So the scenario is, I'm going to work in London, I need to set up a conference call, mobile, this page, 3 seconds, bang, done, that's it. So the whole proposition is about instant service, and their page kind of follows that. So again, correctly relevant, they've understood what the journey is, and they've built the content around that.
Our meetings own brand, on the other hand, invoiced, contract, big B2B play, more about unified communications. We talked about it last week. Cisco WebEx, Skype for Business, much bigger proposition than just quick conference call everybody on their phones. This is about screen sharing, collaboration. SEO is absolutely crucial, because from a brand point of view, it's an endorsement of our brand that we're high up the non-paid for search area of Google. If you're a big corporation or public sector organization, you're less likely to be influenced by a pay-per-click ad for something like Meeting Zone than you are if you're just looking for a quick conference call with any provider. You don't care, you're not gonna have any loyalty, there's no ongoing relationship. So it's about getting the balance. That's not to say it's not important. Pay-per-click is still important, but the balance is the other way around. So you've got to think about that, when it comes to the relevance of the media and the message to the target audience. It's a brand statement. Being higher up the natural search rankings is a brand statement. You sort of, that's quite good, I respect that.
The general thumb is, if you could be first page, paid search, and first on the organic search, that's really good. Because some people will think, I just want to check these guys out. If you're picking on both, it's credibility. And people, it's like, so if you're buying, going to a shop, and you're shopping around, generally you'll look for things that appear more often, because you're familiar with it, and you're going to actually engage with them. The same here. So the more places you can appear,
more chance of people engaging with you.
What do you think the role of our website is from Meeting Zone, having sort of had a good chance to look at it now and heard what Rob said and what I said? Anyone? I'll start picking up people.
What do you mean by the role?
What role is it playing in the sales process or the decision-making process of potential customers, do you think?
Well, I know you've got like the different packages on there, don't you? So you're trying to sell them a certain package.
Let's take a step back.
You're a reseller, aren't
you? Let's take a step back. So what do you, go to the homepage, sir.
Sorry?
Go to the homepage.
Yeah.
Just click on
that. That's the first tab is products and services.
Yeah. So when you go to this website, what do you think? What's the first thing it hits you?
Service.
Yeah, service. Anyone else? So this bit here, basically you're being drawn to this bit here, right?
Yeah.
Well done, excellent. Tick. That's what we want you to do.
Okay,
well,
so
Cisco Spot on mobile?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Excellent.
I wasn't sure if you had
that's
mobile software.
That is right, that's right. In fact, that whole service is built around mobile.
Oh, so you're developing that now, are you?
Exactly. Well, it's not actually a Cisco have there, but we...
so it's not live yet?
It's live yet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I can show you.
Yeah.
I've got Cisco Spark
set
up here.
Cool.
Do you want to see it? Just
sure.
As a bit of interest. Sorry, I'm going to use my brain backwards here. Just use it forwards is bad enough. Okay, there's our video content room.
She would.
So this is an ongoing IM dialogue, but if you scroll up, you can see that we've shared documents in this room. This is like this is a virtual room, project room, command and control center we call it, where everything related to this project called video content is chucked in. There's four or five people that are running, that are involved in the project. We're actually going to create a video based around Spark to demo it. And this is the preparation we do. So we can share documents, we can exchange IMs. If we want to, we can escalate the whole thing to a video conference or an audio conference. We can bring more people in. We can IM each other. So I could IM Johan in Sweden, who's a member of this group, now. Remember I did with Andy Chapman last week, or 2 weeks ago? It was a bit of a disaster, but you got the idea. Didn't have any audio. But we could do the same with Johan in Sweden, and suddenly three of us are on a IM exchange, just like WhatsApp.
Yeah.
But if we want to escalate to video, hey, let's just share this document, we could share it, etc., etc. So it's a brilliant tool. So that's one of the things that we're pushing.
So this is really for project work. So do you guys do project work?
Yeah.
Okay, so for example, your lecture, what's your name, sorry?
Cassidy.
And so your name?
Andrew.
Andrew, so if you guys were in a project team, and a lecturer's working in London, Kirsty's working in, where do you live, sorry?
Mm-hmm.
Marlow, and yourself here in Sweden, wherever, for example. I'm trying to mix up here. And you've got an assignment you're trying to work on, and the old situation, it was at university, and people were in projects, it was like, oh yeah, I can't make the meeting because I'm doing something, we're going to the pub, you know, standard thing. With this tool here, it allows you to kind of collaborate wherever you are, whenever you are. So, that should be on a mobile. Okay, I'm just uploading this document, I've just done my bit of work. Kirsty's been on a laptop. Yeah, Kirsty's pretty cool, yeah. I can add my bits of the assignments. And your man over there, he has his bit in Sweden when he's ready. So it's a great way of having that instant collaboration wherever you are, whatever you're doing. And that's what you're doing at all.
And that's why we've moved on from conference calls, interesting you said conference calls, to actually a completely different way of working. You know, this is changing the way people work. And if you look at our website and our broad corporate positioning, we spent a bit of time on this last time, yeah, that's the way people are thinking now. You know, leaders of industries and organisations and public sector organisations are saying, they think we've got to change the way we work because we've got to be more efficient. You know, government, that public sector blog, which go and have a read of it, is all about people in public sector having to do more for less. You know, the government, the current economic situation means there's a big squeeze on public finances. There's all sorts of pressures on local authorities to provide services with less money and less resource. So it's all about doing more for less. And that's where we come in, because if you give people these tools, they can be much more efficient. So Rob's analogy of you guys doing a quick Spark meeting on a project, brilliant. If you had to physically get into central London to meet, You've got the cost of that, you've got the time of that, it would take 3 days to organise it. You'd
right
be in the pub, you know, you wouldn't do anything. So you can see in a working environment, and we've 2 years now we've been using this, we've significantly increased our efficiency. And that's the way that the world is going now. And yeah, there's a bit of a lag because the people at the top of these organisations are still a bit old school, you know. Whereas the people that are coming through, like you guys, you've grown up with all this. You know, you've got your hangouts, you've got your Apple, the FaceTime, and you don't think anything of this sort of stuff. So there's a whole sort of revolution taking place. That
so I'd be interested, anyone should use Google Hangouts or FaceTime?
Yeah, I use FaceTime.
Yeah.
One
like
to one or one to many?
Just for the parents, usually one to one.
Yeah.
It's quicker, it's easier over the broadband because the bandwidth's better than the phone.
Sure.
From where I am.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's not a very good signal. So.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's free.
Yeah, and
it's free. Yeah.
Yeah.
But that makes a big difference though. I mean, something like Cisco Spark, where you have to pay for it, right? It's a premium piece of software. You guys wouldn't have been used to that. And coming into the company for the first time, or you know, starting RTU, you have to get used to it.
Yep.
Something like FaceTime would have, you know, that amount of familiarity.
Absolutely.
And if they moved into the business space,
yeah,
they'll take it with them.
It's funny you just mentioned that, Greg. We've actually brought on board three grads recently, and I was chatting to them saying, oh, you know, are you familiar with this kind of software? They're like, well, not the actual names, but the concept I am, yeah, because I use Google Hangouts, did for a few assignments, use FaceTime, use normal Skype. So you guys are actually familiar with this kind of, you know, online collaboration space of communicating. And that's what Simon's saying. And now these big businesses are actually saying, right, actually, we need to get on this bandwagon because that's the way of the world. That's how people communicate now.
The legal profession is a good example. Our guy Dan Lancaster has been looking after the legal sector for 5 years, and it's been terribly behind the times. You can imagine lawyers, you know, don't like to change the way things are done, and there's all sorts of issues with data integrity, because you know if you're managing a case and it's suddenly documents are flying around the internet and they can be got hold of by anybody or sent to the wrong person. Got to be very careful with all this stuff. So there's been a reticence to do collaboration, sharing documents, etc. But now, because the new breed of lawyers coming through these firms are starting to get to the top of these organisations, they're saying, well, come on guys, you know, you've got to change. So there's pressure from beneath as well as from below. And we need to, you know, we're playing in that market now. So, yeah, what Rob was saying earlier about the importance of SEO, getting in front of people, when they're looking, you know, surrounded with all this noise, and then when they think about, actually, we need to do something about this, yeah, oh, that meeting's on, yeah, I saw that blog, yeah, I understand all that, and then hopefully come across us by searching for us and, you know, using the terms, and Rob's expertise is in making sure that those terms are right at the top of the list when it comes to Google, particularly Google, which is still, what, 85%?
Yeah, that's another challenge. I've got a question to ask you guys. What was the last big thing you bought? The last, let's say, over £100?
I bought some headphones.
What headphones were they?
Bose headphones.
Why did you buy those headphones?
Because they're the best sound quality.
Why are they the best sound quality?
Because that's how they brainwash you into thinking that.
Okay, that's good. So how do they brainwash you?
Just by their reputation.
What reputation comes from?
Sort of like word of mouth.
Okay.
When
you purchased the item, did you check it out? Go to a website?
Yeah.
Did you read stuff?
Yeah, I read reviews and stuff.
Okay. So there you go. So that's another thing, guys, reviews. When I go to a restaurant, first thing I do is I go to TripAdvisor, check out the ratings on it.
Yeah.
And you could do the same thing. For us, that's something we're trying to get into, reviews, because that's real people giving real feedback on your services. And that is the kind of marketing dynamite. You can get really high reviews, as the man said here, people get by. It's not just us saying it, it's real people saying it. A lot of companies start to do that now. There's new platforms on Google popping up where people can write, give reviews, also write little testimonials as well. So again,
I think that's what Bose do on their website. So.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. In fact, PowerNow had an app on there as well. It's cool, but literally, it was essentially where you can literally rate the service and give feedback as well. So, again, really, really powerful marketing tool.
So picking up on the rating thing, I mean, you've got a very complex product and you almost want to break it down into certain features.
Exactly.
Do you have sort of side-by-side comparisons with, we were talking earlier about some of the producers and suppliers, and we potentially looked at competitors as well, so things like Slack, for example.
Mm.
How does that sort of compare on a feature-by-feature basis with the likes of Skype for Business, for example?
One of the things we've learned from the content on the website is not to try and cover every single ground here. I asked about the role of the website deliberately because it's really to confirm. A lot of people come to our website just to confirm that we know what we're talking about and almost endorse their decision to put us on a shortlist. If the website, and we learned the hard one, this, didn't we?
Yeah.
We tried to cover every single angle on the last website,
okay.
And the content was getting more and more complex, deeper and deeper and deeper, and people couldn't find what they wanted. It's too. So, doing comparisons with other services is quite hard because, in the end, it depends on how the people are going to use those services. That's quite a detailed sales conversation. So our job in marketing is to get people engage with us, hopefully to open up a dialogue with us, over to the sales guys. Okay, I'll take you through Citrix, I'll take you through Slack versus Spark, I'll take you through Skype for Business versus whatever it is. And that's where that role comes in. So we don't tend to get too far down that line on the website. What we will do is we'll push hard at any, I say USPs, there's no, argument about whether USPs really exist in this market or any market. They probably don't, but there are things that we do well that we think differentiate us, and that's built around our service, our post-sales follow-up, our rollout, our training, our customer support. So those are the things we push hard. And in the end, it's like anything. If somebody says to you, I'm a great footballer, you'll say, well, I'd like to see you play. And that's where reviews come in. You don't believe them until you've actually seen them play on the park. So it's about that. Prove yourself, Meeting Zone. And that's what we're doing on the website.
Well, I was just wondering what sense they're a threat to you, or you could actually potentially use something like Slack. Whether it be, whether something's going to sort of...
I think in our industry, a lot of these types of meetings, they're all pretty much the same. What people, so from a Meeting Zone point, we tend to look for is what is the service. You can have an amazing bit of software. But if you had to use it, we're not being trained, there's no good. And that's why, say, from the legal sector as an example, these people don't really care about price. What they want is a nice bit of software that you can actually train me, you can support me, and you're always there for me. That's their proposition. And that's generally probably the way we want to push our kind of brand, is that we offer that kind of bespoke touch, that white glove service, where we're always there for you, because some people find technology very difficult to comprehend. The basic conference call is like, well, how do I do that? Like, put the phone up, dial a number. Oh, right. We find it difficult. So they ring us up, they get training on it. It takes like 20 minutes, but that's the level you're going deep with. You guys are obviously quite familiar with that. You're technically much more sound, but we have other people who don't get technology. And that makes up a large portion of our kind of customer base. So for us, it's always about the service.
So, sorry, just to take that a little further. Do you need to be quite agile in the way you approach this, or you've chosen two partners which you're going to stick with kind of indefinitely?
They are the market leaders. I mean, sorry, if you want to talk about the...
I think I showed you last time, I've got the slides here, the Gartner Magic Quadrant, where WebEx and Skype for Business and Cisco were right, top right, visionaries and ability to execute. And everything else was sort of in their wake. And it's a bit like John Lewis. If it's on a shelf in John Lewis, they've chosen to sell that brand because they think it's a good one, and they've got the. So we're a reseller. We're a retailer in that respect. You can't stock everything, but we believe and we know we're stocking the two solutions that are both market leaders in their respective fields. And if you remember, I talked about one of them's coming at this market from a software perspective, Microsoft. On every single PC, it might well be an infrastructure, the built infrastructure of a firm may be built around that, in which case telephony can be bolted onto that. Or you've got the telephony approach, usually driven by Cisco, where the infrastructure is built around switches and what we call PBXs, which are big sort of exchanges, they're all going now, it's going software wise. So the battleground is in the middle, and both these brands are coming at it from both ends. And we've got the best in both.
Yeah.
So that's why we're doing what we do.
Just another question to the group. What brands do you guys like? Why do you like Apple?
They're easy to use.
Yeah.
They're very like user friendly. And it's just surrounding me now. Apple products are the biggest.
Yeah. On HP.
Yeah.
And do you like their reputation? Do you think that?
Yeah. I've never had a problem with them.
Okay. Anyone else? Brands that you like?
Who's wearing something? What are you wearing? Do you need his trainers on? You had a Ralph Lauren hoodie last time.
We had a similar sort of conversation. Good conversation.
So why do you like Adidas and Ralph Lauren?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a reputation. Yeah. And when you go and buy these stuff, do you look around, or do you know exactly what you want generally?
I know kind of what brand I want. I look around and what the brand offers.
Right. Okay. And you shop online or in store?
Shop online mostly.
Yeah. Anyone else? Brands they like? Chap in the hat.
Innocent Drinks.
Why do you like Innocent Drinks?
The kind of stuff they post about on social media is not always relevant to me, but for the kind of product they are, they want to market themselves as an everyday product.
Right.
So they talk about everyday things.
Okay. So you respect their proposition around that, the fact they're
yeah.
quite honest and open, they're trying to engage with you.
Yeah, and their sense of humour is always on the nose, and that's always appreciated.
So you think they're a brand by real people, not just a kind of stiff corporation they are?
Yeah. Yeah, it's the kind of direction they take in terms of soft selling rather than
yeah.
being very in your face, quite like that.
And do you follow them on social media? Twitter?
Yeah.
Facebook?
Yes, and Instagram.
Okay, good. So you've bought into that whole.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. And do you drink their drinks regularly?
No, not all the time.
Okay. Sorry, what's wrong?
No, that's
okay. I'm just interested. Anyway, one last person.
About the lady in the corner.
Go ahead.
What brands do you like?
Nike.
Why do you like Nike?
Just the way it's advertised and. Reputation.
Okay.
The popularity.
Okay. So the reason I'm asking these questions is the kind of point called brand recognition. So if you're on Twitter or walk in London and up pops a Nike banner, would you look at it?
Yeah.
Because it's Nike. Because
mm-hmm.
you think, oh yeah, Nike, fantastic. I get them. Because I know that brand, they're respected. It's the same thing for us. We're doing some banners around our two power brands. And the first thing we do is we have logo in there, because we know, as they said, there is that brand recognition. I know Cisco is a reputable brand, so I'm going to look at it. I know Microsoft's a reputable brand, so I'm going to look at it. So that brand recognition, if you can get that as a marketeer, again, you're halfway there.
Mm.
The story's halfway sold to you.
So just going back to Andrew's point about innocent, if you have a look on the website, a lot of the images are stock images, and I wonder if that has, you know, if people look at them and they go, well, it's a little bit.
What Innocent do, this is actually very glad you put that up. So I was in a conference with them, it was last year, big Microsoft conference, and their CEO was talking about their marketing. And one of the things they do really, really well is conceptualise what they're talking about. So they have some really nice images that tell you a story. So one of the things he was saying is they had a thing last year on Fridays, you know. Last day of the week, it's Friday, you know, you're on your way to work, have an innocent drink. Why is that good? Because they tweet at 8:20 in the morning, so most people are on their way to work. It's Friday. So immediately they're putting into the real time. I'm associating with that because I know it's Friday, it's early. You know, it's the last day of the week, so yes, fantastic, great. And you know, celebrate with this instant smoothie. And it was saying actually that one tweet generates an X amount of revenue because you're tapping into what's happening around in the real time. And that's what they do really, really well. These kind of little brands, they're having these kind of conversations with you subliminally all the time using social media.
So that's just the narrative on the top. I mean, the choice of images, is that
telling the story? So they find a picture, got the information, the narrative, they put the two together. Easy, a lot of people don't do it very well. They spend a lot of time getting that right and executing every single day.
Yeah.
So building that
in the right tone of voice. So here we are, I'm on BT Internet, or the BT.com site here. Okay, and the reason I go on this is because I use BT Internet as my private email address, so I have to log on from this page. And when you scroll down, Rob, why don't you explain?
But this
is
one of our retargeting banners. So people who've gone onto our website, they're looking around, they see Cisco, so they're a Cisco in their heads. They'll look around, yeah, it's interesting, I'm going to go elsewhere. He goes to the BT Internet. And this little banner follows them around. You've all probably seen this, you know, when you're shopping on John Lewis or buying Apple stuff, Alpha Red stuff, whatever. You go on the internet and these little things will pop up. And that brand recognition thing in them, it's always there.
I'm going into my internet account, my email, sorry. And there's a chance that I'm going to be using it because I might need to contact some people. Yeah, I've been on the meeting zone site, so it's picked me up through cookies. So it's all about relevance, and it's about surrounding me as a potential customer. Obviously, I'm working for Meeting Zone, so that's why I've gone on the site. But if I wasn't working for Meeting Zone, this would follow me on other sites as well. So yeah, it's about the train station stimulation, you know, the Nike message at the right time, and following people around.
What a lot of companies do is they will plan this journey. So when they're building their campaigns, that's okay, right? What do we want people to do? We want to get them to our website or some sort of landing page. We want to either transact them straight away, educate them. If we're educating them, we obviously want to keep top of mind, right? And that's where this stuff comes in. So actually building your content that's relevant for the retargeting. So this one here is very simple. We know people are interested in Cisco. Bang. First thing you see is the logo. Instant recognition. And then telling our story down here. Because we know this content here is relevant. That target audience we've done our testing.
So that's through AdRoll, is that right? Yeah. And how do you, what sort of, how much control do you have over where that lands?
You can do whatever you want with it. So this one here is going back to the UK WebEx page. You can build these anywhere you want, pretty much. There you go, see.
Oh, sorry, the other way around. So in terms of where those ads are positioned.
So AdRoll they are what's called a premier network provider. So not just on Google, on Bing, Facebook, LinkedIn.
And you have a choice of where that space is going
to
be.
So the way it works is you have an ad and then AdRoll then resize it depending on where you are. So if you're a top side user, we have ads that go up for the top here, and that size. Big size, wherever really. I think it's 24 different specs you can have.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty dominant when you look at the context of that page.
But in terms of the ad space, you go, I want that to land on BT's homepage. Do you have that sort of level of choice?
No. You can do. There are other platforms where you can literally point them at certain things. So the Daily Mail is a prominent one. A lot of companies try and get on Daily Mail website.
Mm-hmm.
That is very heavy traffic on there. But obviously costs more money. We don't have that budget, unfortunately, to push them where we want to. We have to rely on.
And what do you pay for? What's the rough sort of cost of that?
This one's very cheap. It's like £500 a month, which in retargeting terms is like nothing. But it's quite a new platform, so
we get a lot of eyeballs. Don't we wrong for that?
Yeah, £500 would get you 20,000 eyeballs.
And do you get to choose whether it's going to be click through or eyeballs? Is that your?
It's the whole ad is clickable. So what generally happens is people just see it. In their mind, they'll type in Meeting Zone.
Yeah, but in terms of where you pay for it, do you pay for it if they see it, or do you pay for it when they
click
on it?
Click on it.
So you can get that free if they don't click on it.
Exactly.
And once you've used up your allowance, so getting the target audience identified.
What's interesting about this is the volume of people typing in Meeting Zone into Google has increased since we launched it. Because you've got that brand recognition in people's heads.
Just like Nike. Just like that, Ralph Lauren. Yeah, the whole B2B world has changed. You know, we are much more like B2C when it comes to, there's much more of an emotional connection, even in the driest of public sector organisations. You know, because basically, one of the issues for public sector is, as we said there, taking people with them, you know, getting people in those organisations to be able to use the stuff. And that's quite an emotional play, you know. And it's just like your Adidas trainers, and if you chose a pair of Nike equivalent, there wouldn't be any difference in quality, really. I mean, there might be a little bit here and there, but it's all Me Too stuff, isn't it, really? You pay £50 and £50, you're going to get the same sort of quality. Pay £100, you'll get better quality, but it'll be the same. Yeah, Cisco WebEx is the same whether you buy it from us or any other provider. But it's how we wrap the service around it that makes the difference. So, you know, it is the John Lewis, you know, it's that factor. You get somebody in John Lewis who's worked on the vacuum cleaner department for 25 years, they know every single thing there is to know about vacuum cleaner technology and will bore you, you know, ceaselessly as a result. But you like that because you know you're going to get that. If you go to Argos, well, you're lucky if the thing that comes out the back of the warehouse is the right product. It's got all the right bits in it, you know. I'm joking, I mean, I exaggerate, but you get the idea. That's what makes a difference for us in B2B as a service provider.
Do you guys have any questions?
How long is your free trial?
30 days.
So they get 30 days.
Correct.
Is that for anything? So if they're on Skype for Business or WebEx?
What we try and do, as I mentioned, we try and get into a dialogue, so you want to contact us. And if you're a really big customer, that potentially could earn £1,000, also affected in market to 60 days or whatever.
Okay.
So we are flexible. And that's the game, going back to the service thing here. We always try and listen to people. We don't want to talk to you. Listen to what your needs are, and then build out.
How long is your contract with Cisco and Microsoft to resell the software?
That's a good question. I don't actually know.
But, I mean, you've hit on a very important point. It's, you know, the relationship that we have with those guys is, you know, the part of the reason we do this branding is the trade, you know, and I worked in retail advertising for quite a while, and I worked on the Sharp account in its heyday when microwave ovens were, you know, £250, just been launched over. A lot of trade advertising is aimed at, a lot of advertising by B2C is aimed at the trade. So if, for example, you are a vacuum cleaner manufacturer like Dyson, and you're advertising. Yeah, you're advertising because you want housewives and men to endorse it and go out and buy it. But you're also advertising to John Lewis to stock it, because they're thinking, well, if they're advertising it, it won't sit on the shelves for very long. So there's a huge trade play here, and that's another reason we do this, to look good to the trade. So the relationship that we have with those guys is crucial. And we spend as much time nurturing that as we do nurturing relationship with potential customers. Contract wise, we are a Microsoft Gold partner, as you've probably seen on the website, for communication and for hosting. WebEx wise, we are a preferred partner. You have to have qualifications, and engineers have to be tested, and people have to be tested and reach certain levels.
Yeah.
There are contracts, particularly with Microsoft. I don't know about the WebEx contracts, but we do have good relationships with them, and we punch above our weight. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've got people. Yeah. We. There are far bigger service providers than us dealing with Cisco and Microsoft, but I would argue that very few have got the depth of relationships that we have, and that's because the people we have in our teams spend the time and have got the expertise to do that. It's a really good question. And I think when you're looking at this, you've got to look at it from the point of view of, okay, making sure that our providers, our suppliers, if you like, you know, the two leading products, actually still want to be selling through us. Because if they said to us, sorry, Meaty, don't piss off, we don't want you anymore, we're vulnerable.
Yeah, it's marketing to the vendors, exactly. We want to show them, actually, we're doing all this great stuff, you know, give us some additional credibility.
Yep.
So it works both ways.
And it is important, because there are retailers, for example, you don't go into, because you know they don't stock the brands that you want.
Yeah.
And up until recently, you know, the Aldis and of this world. They didn't stock some of the big brands. So what they've done is they've created their own brand. They've spent quite a lot of time actually creating a perception of value and quality around their own brands.
That's actually a question actually to ask the guys.
Yeah,
what's
sure.
a brand they don't like? Now I pick on the lady in the hoodie. Brand you don't like?
Crocs.
Yeah.
Sorry?
I'd say Apple.
Don't like Apple? Okay.
Apple.
Okay.
I just don't like... I just see Apple as one of those companies that are all big-headed and
Right.
They know
very
the same and
arrogant.
Arrogant, yeah.
Okay. Good one.
Yeah.
Anybody else? Think airlines. Any airline brand you don't like?
Aeroflot.
Aeroflot.
How are they making a big? They made a big investment. They're fake. They're trying to improve their image from the 80s and 90s.
Change their name.
Yeah, they should do that. Yeah.
What's the big car brand that everybody used to laugh at? That's the
Skoda.
Yeah. Why was that?
Make crap cars.
Yeah, shit cars, aren't they?
Why do you make crap cars?
Because of poor quality, there were no training standards in that part of the world.
Yeah.
Then what?
Do you still think they make crap cars now?
No, because they've changed their perception
okay.
at the time. Yeah.
And what else have they changed?
What else have they changed? Like, yeah.
Who owns them?
Volkswagen.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. It's basically a VW in disguise. Whereas before it was made in Czechoslovakia.
Yeah. So here's a fact for you guys. Red Hat, pub, whatever. Skoda Octavia is exactly the same as an Audi A4.
Yeah.
Exactly the same apart from the outer chassis. $30,000 difference in price.
Huge difference in price.
But perception wise, what would you rather buy? Audi or Skoda?
Definitely an Audi.
There you go.
And
you pay for it, right? You pay for it.
I can take an Audi.
Do you think it's any more expensive to produce a Skoda than it is an Audi?
No. It's more powerful.
So what are they doing? They're creating a huge margin. What's perfume?
Yeah.
You know, brands are all about stretching the margin potential from the base cost. But there's a big but here, huge but. What do you have to do to make sure that you can command that premium? Yeah, you've got to add value. And that means if Skoda hadn't been bought by VW, and they decided to change their image and go up market, but the product was exactly the same, what would happen?
They would sell less of that car.
Yeah,
so we
can't command it.
Yeah.
So you've got to, so if, for us, you know, if we let our service standards slip and we're pushing a service message, we'll get away with it for a while, won't we? I mean, we'd probably, you know, maybe a year, 18 months, suddenly, with social media, with reviews. Yeah, it works the same way, you know, LinkedIn, Facebook, we're on everything. Yeah, that could really undo us. So it's really important to manage the quality of the service as well as the quality of the brand, how it comes across, the tone of voice, etc. Got to get the two right. And it's really interesting what you say, because yeah, the one that always comes to mind is Ryanair. Anybody like Ryanair? Does anybody like Ryanair?
I mean,
EasyJet.
Yeah, I'd be on EasyJet quite a lot.
Yeah. What's your experience with EasyJet?
Well, if I'm booking a holiday, it's just cheap.
It's cheap. You don't care, do you?
Yeah. Oh, really? If I'm going to Europe, no.
Expect you're going to be 2 hours late.
Yeah,
you know?
Be 2 hours.
It's a nice bonus if you get there on time.
But,
you know?
but that's your associated with that brand. You think EasyJet,
yeah.
Late, crap service, generally. Cheap, but I don't mind.
But then, if you're going to go with British Airways, you know it's going to be a better service
exactly.
overall.
Okay.
There's my money.
Brand reputation, that's the thing.
And often it comes from the top. Ryanair's run by a guy called Michael O'Leary.
Yeah,
you may have heard of him. He's an obnoxious man who hates his customers. Really, you get the feeling he doesn't actually enjoy his job. And why should anybody like that brand? Only that it's cheap. But the danger of that is that. Cheap is not good enough differentiator. You've got to add value. And even though EasyJet, yeah, it is cheap, you know, there's still a perception of slightly superior quality, the feel of it, etc. And they're probably, they treat their customers better than Ryanair. You know, you're prepared to accept, if you go into Poundland, that you know, the quality of the service is going to be a little bit lower than if you go into Fordham and Mason's. You know,
manage your expectations. And brands are like people. Some you like, some you don't. Some people are arrogant, some people are not arrogant. Some people, you like their arrogance. There's a confidence about them. Appeals to you. Other people you can't stand. Same with brands. It's all emotional. Unless they're particularly obnoxious. So we've got 10 minutes. Is there any questions on the assignment or anything that Rob's talked about or anything that I've talked about last week or wherever it was that you want to clarify before we go? It's your last chance.
How much do you charge your customers? Because your prices aren't on your website, or does it depend?
Totally free.
No, we have a bespoke service. So again, someone rings in, listen to what they want. For example, if you're ringing in and you want to book some conference calls for 1,000 people, they'll give you a bespoke price for that. If your man next to you rings in and says, I want to book a conference call for 2 people, the price will be a bit different. So again, it's this flexibility around what the customer wants. So we try to contact us, have that conversation.
We can't ask what margins you charge, do
you?
Very good ones. One of the things that, as a business, we run very well as a business, and the guys that run it have high, look for high margins. And that's because in a service industry, you have to invest in service, in the infrastructure that goes with it. We've learned the hard way, we've failed on this one, haven't we, Rob? A couple of years ago, January 2013 or 14, we had a major failure with one of our bridges. Bridges where people dial in and the bridge brings everybody together in a call. The bridge went down and we had about 3 or 4 weeks of really poor service. We learned the hard way, And those brands that invest in their service. And a good example, I always use this as an example, is my barber, right? You may not think I need one, but my barber started out, he had one chair in a shop in the place where I live, and then he put a second chair in, and finally he was getting some customers. They put a third chair in, and I said to him, have you got enough business here to get a third chair in and a third barber? He said, no, but when people look in, and they see that there's 3 chairs and 3 barbers, they'll know that they won't have to wait. How many barbers do you think in chairs he's got now? He's just put his 6th in. He didn't need it at the time, but he thought ahead. He thought, actually, this is sending out the right message. I'm investing in my service.
And building perception as well, that's a big marketing. Build the right perception, people engage.
Yeah. And he gets the other bits right, gets the pricing right, the atmosphere, the tone of voice, the quality, etc., etc. Whether it's a good barber or not, I don't know, you would never be able to tell from what I have done, but obviously he is, because other people who've got more hair than I have actually come back. So yeah, it is definitely invest in your service is a key thing.
So how would you relate that to your company?
To us?
Yeah.
Don't wait for things to go wrong. Think about how you can improve, add the value to what you're doing, for people to want to work with you, stay with you, emotionally feel that, and communicate that. We're investing in a new bridge. We just put a new bridge into Asia Pac in Hong Kong. Tell people that. Give them a feeling that we take our service provision seriously. And as a brand who exists purely on reputation of service and quality of service delivery, what we have to do. And Rob and I are constantly wrestling with the accountants in the firm, and indeed the CEO, who's a bit of a tight guy. You say, we can get away with it, And you can't come a cropper. And there's been a few examples lately of poor quality of service and poor follow through in terms of the way that brands have managed that with their customers. If you do that and you do have a service problem, you've got quite a bit of goodwill that you can use and you can overcome that. In the same way that if your friend lets you down for a reason, but you know that genuinely they didn't mean it to happen and they're
something happened unexpectedly, blah blah. You forgive them. Same with brands. You know, but you can't do that forever, and there'll come a point when you'll lose trust. And that trust is worth a lot of money. We talked about this last time, the Samsung value of the Samsung organization. What was the decline in the value following the fire issue with the S7? Do you remember what it was? 22% of their global value was wiped off.
Whatever you buy a Samsung. You got a Samsung?
Yeah.
You're like Apple.
Are you gonna, your next phone, you're gonna buy another Samsung? So then you've got brand loyalty. That's back to what Simon said there is, if I had a disaster, but because I've got that goodwill with you, you're still gonna go back to them.
I'm the same, I'd probably say the same. I'm not sufficiently, I like the battery life. I think Apple battery life's rubbish. That for me is important.
The UI system is a lot nicer. It's simple. Apple is just like everything everywhere. It just looks funny. But that's
however, if the J7 started to explode, spontaneously combust in certain situations, which is the phone I've got, I might switch to Apple. in other words, there's a limit to how much loyalty you have with friends and with brands and people and family. They let you down, then you forgive, but not all the time, not without any.
Just conscious, we've got 5 minutes left, and two questions I think might be able to help you guys. The first one being your communications budget. How do you split that? What sort of areas, you talked about paid search and organic, what other areas are there, and how do you split that budget?
Well, a lot of it does come under those two categories. We have a budget assigned for just content creation. Whether it's blogs, PR, infographics, any kind of dynamic content that we need comes out of that. I think three kind of main areas. We do lots of in-house now, so.
Yeah, a lot of in-house. A lot of brand refresh, all the design work came out of this year's budget. Next year, we've done this, we want to put that money into really driving people to the site, creating more interesting content. One of the things that we'd like you guys to come back with is some other ways that we can get relevant content to our target audience. Should we be using Instagram, for example? Are there any other social media platforms you think we should be using? Or what sort of content should we be producing? We're not very strong on video, for example. Be interested in your thoughts on that.
So just in sort of picking up on that, the process that you go about looking for that, would you do keyword research, or how would you go about finding content?
Finding content.
Finding topics to write about.
Yeah, so again, as I mentioned at the beginning of the session, we do a lot of what's called test campaigns. So we'll pick out the sector we're interested in, and we'll just test messaging. And from that, we'll understand, okay, this message, say, online meetings aren't great, blah, blah, blah. That's a hook for us then to develop content around that. That's what Simon's showing around the blogs. So we know the content is going to be correct. Also, as well, going on Twitter, having a look around. Twitter's a great way of finding out content that people are interested in. Our partners, they produce a lot of great content now. So again, it's a lot of combination of different things.
Would you look at competitors as well?
Yeah.
Absolutely, definitely. Like Power Now, again, they're a competitor, they do a great job with their content.
They spend a lot of time on remote working, new ways of working, talking about those sorts of areas. I'll go online, I'll do Google searches, I'll check the Twitter sphere, what subject matters are being discussed by these people. I found a report by PricewaterhouseCoopers the other day on public sector spending, so that gave me a great sort of opportunity to talk about that in a blog. It is about using content that's out there to create new content, but have our spin on it. Knowing that something like PwC will be read by these people, so you get a feel for it. Rob talks to me about keywords, what subjects are being discussed in social media platforms and forums.
Something that Power Now does really well is they have a calendar of all kind of key dates in there, things like Christmas, Easter, National Flexible Working Day, and they build their content around that. So they'll have a series of content around Flexible Working Day, I think it's in March. They also know when year ends are for a lot of companies. They'll say, year end's coming up, you need a conference call to communicate with people. And they do that very well. In fact, we've actually
looked at what they'd done, because they've been relevant. National Women's Day, you know, a whole heap of things they kind of buy into. That may not be necessarily relevant to their industry, but they're trying to piggyback onto a conversation which is happening in the wider world.
A bit of lateral thinking as well. And again, you guys come back with any thoughts and ideas, we'd be really interested on those. Are there any specific dates or days or events that we should do? I've just created a blog for our general manager on Donald Trump's election and the fact that that's adding to an already uncertain world following Brexit. We've got the French elections coming up, we've got the German elections coming up. There's going to be all sorts of, you know, Trump-like politicians in those countries. Yeah, there's a whole revolution taking place in the way politicians are perceived. So, uncertain world, and what we provide is the ability to manage in that uncertainty. So, you know, that's, so you latch on to things that are happening at macro level as well as micro level within the industry. But any thoughts you have,
yeah,
chuck them our way.
So content strategy, critique of UX, what are the ones? Social media pages.
Yep. In fact, I'll tell you what, I'll put my arse on the line. You know, the best suggestion is going to win a prize. You know, we'll get some John Lewis vouchers or something like that. Audi vouchers. So, you know, anybody that comes up, is that fair, Rob?
Yeah, I think about writing blog as well, maybe.
The best blog or the best piece of content or the best suggestion for content, we'll put a hand in our pockets and we'll make it worth your while.
That's brilliant, thank you.
Yeah? So go for it, guys. Have good luck with the assignment. Some real gems that Rob's thrown your way in terms of things like crazy egg, clicks, stuff like that. You know, you throw these things in, you get marks. It's like one of those pinball machines where, you know, the ball gets stuck and you keep going around and the thing's going on. You know, chuck them all in. You know, do your own research. Find these tools and use them and make it really give you your response and depth. We'd be very interested to hear what you have to say.
Brilliant. Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Any final questions? Anything? We obviously feel them back to you. No? Thank you.
Good luck. Thank you, guys. Thanks.